Good evening. Remains to be seen whether I'm fit to speak tonight. I just wish someone good morning. My name is Paul Carden, and it's a blessing to be with you again this year. As Christians, you and I are commanded to test all things and hold fast to what is good and to abstain from every form of evil. We're also commanded to defend the faith once for all delivered to the saints, and many of us are seeking earnestly to do this, but in spite of that, despite our sincerest efforts and our best intentions, a kind of blindness can come over it, some of us, as it did me. And I thank the Lord that while it may be persistent and even profound, it is not incurable. I want to share a bit with you about my journey with Adventism. See, I first became aware of countercult apologetics on a rainy day when I was in high school. I was visiting a friend. I was bored to tears. I was looking at her bookshelf, and there, popping out at me, as it were, was a book called The Kingdom of the Cults. And I wondered, what on earth is that? I pulled it off, I opened it up, and a whole new world opened up to me. Things I hardly ever imagined. And what the author, Walter Martin, told me about Mormonism and Jehovah's Witnesses and Christian Science and a whole constellation of other groups changed my life. Little did I suspect that that was a doorway to a calling, one that I have pursued ever since. But dear Walter Martin also anesthetized me with that book, which had a 63-page appendix called The Puzzle of Seventh-day Adventism, in which he acknowledged, of course, that while problematic, Seventh-day Adventism still was located somewhere outside the boundaries of the Kingdom of the Cults. It was not a member state of the Kingdom of the Cults. And so I thought, all right, it's not. And that made it easy because in the years that followed, every time I tried to actually read that appendix, my eyes glazed over. There was something obtuse and boring about that one part of the book, which I could not understand. And so I left it alone. But meanwhile, I started attending his class in Anaheim at Melody Land Christian Center. Did any of you ever go to Melody Land? Ah, a few hands, okay. Some of you remember. Kind of a rockin' place in the 70s. Formerly a theater in the round, imagine. And at Melody Land, Walter Martin held forth in a Sunday school class that held at least 500 people every Sunday morning. He took questions live. It was a remarkable thing. And I gobbled up everything he had to say about cults and apologetics and all the rest. I will admit it to you, because Walter Martin was not only the author of The Kingdom of the Cults, he was the godfather of the evangelical countercult movement. He was the original Bible answer man. And it was interesting, because whenever he talked about Seventh-day Adventism, the tone would change markedly. He would talk about the Seventh-day Adventists who were his Christian brothers and sisters. He would talk about lecturing in their Sabbath school classes. He went out of his way as though it were kind of a badge of tolerance. God bless him. And on a more personal level, he credited Seventh-day Adventist medicine, if not with saving his life, indeed with prolonging it. He had a profound gratitude to the Adventists who had extended a personal hand of help to him. He even sent me to an Adventist physician to get all my immunizations the first time he sent me to Africa in 1981. But in the 70s and the 80s, it was a time of great ferment. You probably remember all kinds of crazy news about cults coming out, right? And Seventh-day Adventism was hardly ever in the news, except for maybe the Davenport scandal and Walter Ray and the White Lie. But Adventism seemed odd, but not ominous. Enigmatic, perhaps, but not evil, at least to me at that time. And I knew this, I always knew this, that Walter Martin, the original Bible answer man himself, had at great personal cost staked his very reputation on the position that Seventh-day Adventism was not a cult. And that was good enough for me. The thinking had been done. And I had other fish to fry, theologically. So, well, I'll even add this. As a cult researcher, who'd been around a little bit by then, I knew of ex-Mormon groups. In fact, I'd been very active with one. I knew of ex-Jehovah's Witness groups. I knew of ex-Christian Science groups, ex-Armstrongite groups. I'd never even heard of a former Adventist group. If I can tell you a secret, it stays with you. I didn't really know any Adventists at all. What if? What if? So, in the early 1980s, I moved to Brazil to start a South American branch of the Christian Research Institute. Lo and behold, my colleagues, the Brazilians, were fervently opposed to Seventh-day Adventism. Why? Well, they told me that Seventh-day Adventists were eagerly, actively proselytizing among evangelicals, that there were pastors that they had converted, that they held up as trophies. And I thought, well, this must just be a mutant form of the religion. And I tolerated them graciously. Meanwhile, my first two children were born at the Adventist Hospital of São Paulo. My wife and I eagerly bought and consumed Seventh-day Adventist honey and peanut butter, which were highly praised by missionaries down there. And we frequently dined at the vegetarian restaurant downtown. All was well. And again, as an apologist and a cult researcher, it always seemed to me that where there's smoke, there's fire. And really, about all that seemed to emanate from Seventh-day Adventism was kind of a musty odor. Maybe something from the 19th century, I don't know. And besides, time had shown me that Seventh-day Adventism was a topic on which reasonable people could disagree. So when I came back from Brazil in the late 80s, my colleague, Ken Samples, had actually been going to Loma Linda, meeting with Adventist scholars at least once in the company of Walter Martin himself, and Ken had written a couple of very influential articles on Adventism in which he declared that though there were three distinct flavors of Seventh-day Adventism, none of them met the operational definition of a cult. Again, essentially absolved. But I left the Christian Research Institute in 1995 to start the Centers for Apologetics Research, an extension of the international work I'd been doing. And 3 years later, the video Seventh-day Adventism, The Spirit Behind the Church, came out. And I found parts of it fascinating. It was well done. And though I was better informed, I must confess to you that I was somehow strangely unmoved at a deeper level. I cannot fully account for this to this day. That same year, I went to Chicago for the annual gathering of a group called Evangelical Ministries to New Religions. And whom did I meet there but a fellow named Dale Ratzlaff. Dale Ratzlaff was a former Adventist pastor, and his calm, thorough, systematic way of presenting the errors of Seventh-day Adventism forced me to sit up and pay attention in an entirely new way. It became evident to me that despite all my glancing blows with Adventism, I had never begun to understand it as I had so actively sought to understand the other groups I had studied over many years. Now, fast forward. Not many years after that, I was asked by a local foundation to bring in other discernment ministries to make presentations to their staffs, and so I thought of Dale. And so he and Carolyn and a couple named Richard and Colleen, whose name I forgot earlier this evening, showed up at this gathering and made their presentation. Afterwards, we went out to lunch. And on the basis of that conversation, I discerned that I was crossing a threshold. A very important threshold. And the next step that I took, the next most meaningful step that I took, was to enter the very home of Richard and Colleen in the company of our Russian director, Pasha Stoyarov. And for an entire day, I pressed them hour upon hour with questions and more questions. I sought to fit Adventism historically, culturally and theologically into the categories that would help me determine once and for all with certainty whether I was dealing with a merely marginal movement or something profoundly deceptive and even destructive. And I must tell you, they did not tell me what to think. They engaged with me. They spoke as exhaustively as they could about the things I wanted to know. And I went off and I checked everything that they had said. Fast forward again. And I had finally reached a verdict after engaging with them, with other former Adventists. I had reached a verdict that was disturbing but clear. Seventh-day Adventism distorts or denies nearly every central teaching of the historic Christian faith. Imagine if I had realized that 20 years before. The Seventh-day Adventist Church claims to be God's one special remnant end-time church, led by God's special end-time prophet, Ellen G. White, and along with its bizarre unscriptural views on the Trinity and the person and work of Christ, the great controversy theme, the investigative judgment, and the incredible amount of material that Ellen simply made up under the cover of her prophetic office. Adventism confuses law and gospel. It denies the biblical doctrine of hell. It claims that Satan is a sin bearer for Christians. It denies that human beings possess an immortal and immaterial soul or spirit. It even promotes the deceptive clear word Bible as a valid form of scripture. And I realized something. I realized that if we are not willing to confront the errors of Adventism, then we have to question our commitment to Romans and Galatians and Colossians. Because if those errors were deadly then, they are no less deadly today. And souls are at stake. We cannot, we must not remain silent. I don't know everyone in this room. It's probably just as well. But perhaps your mind and heart are in a place much like the one where I was for so many years. If you're at a crossroads, where you are seated tonight is quite likely the very best place you could be to continue your journey with Adventism. Individual Seventh-day Adventists need the biblical gospel. I believe this. I know this as surely as I am standing before you. Institutional Adventism, which binds them with spiritual chains, must be responsibly exposed and consistently, conscientiously opposed. If we love the truth, we will oppose the errors of Adventism by every available and appropriate means. And if we love the truth, we will love the Adventist people enough to speak the truth about them and to them, with humility, conviction, and compassion. And if you are not acquainted with Life Assurance Ministries, I assure you, these qualities are modeled by this ministry. Love is not apathy. Love is not silence. When I did not know, I could not love as I ought. But now I do know, and I have no choice. None of us whose eyes have been opened to the depth of deception in Adventism does.